Okay, we are rolling. This is my little tester, just to make sure that the frame is working over here. There we go. And you guys have just seen my little tester. Make sure everything's looking dandy before we begin. So here we go.
COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
The death toll in Italy has now surpassed 10,000.
Once more, I will shake not only the earth,
he's urging all residents,
but also the health,
stay in their home,
so that what cannot be shaken may remain.
Your rooted in Jesus.
Alrighty, guys, no jokes. This is about the sixth time I've tried to record this intro and I am like getting it wrong every time. So my name is Howard, I'm a dude from Cape Town and welcome to Almost Church. It's not quite church because we can't meet together, but it's the closest thing we've got in these dark days. We're gonna kick off with some greetings from around the world. In case you forgot, we're part of 412. What I love about being part of this church field is when you make these deep relationships with people from around the world and you see them in the flesh at one of our gatherings or conferences, there's just this beautiful like unity. You know what I'm talking about. If you see your friend from the Isle of Man or from like Zambia or Malawi or whatever, and you're like, it's you. And it's just like, there's a real love between people who serve the same God. There's this like beautiful connection that is unparalleled. Like literally the unity that the Holy Spirit brings, guys. So let's hear what the 412 family has got to say.
Hi, my name is Takudwa.
Hi, my name is Tabiwa.
Hi, my name is Esa.
Magadi Muria Fortko Sutarangondini Patients from Josh Jenarari. Tino Para Tirimunom Tisarira. Tino Wimba Chongana Futizok Mine.
Hi, 412. It's Lee from Oxygen Life Church in Port Elizabeth. Just sending you lots and lots of love.
Hey, guys, from 412 Church. I'm Esther from Brazil and from Estação 337, and I'm sending you guys a lot of love in this time of quarantine. We hope that you guys still doing well, and that's it. God bless you all. Bye.
Hi, I'm Joe.
Hi, I'm Becca. We're from Living Hope Church on the Isle of Man.
And we're just going to send a big hello and lots of love.
Greeting you out of a wonderful, warm Lusaka, Zambia. Going to worship with you guys this morning. Trust you're going to love the meeting. Miss you guys. Can't wait to see you again.
Hey, everybody. It's Luke here from Perth in Western Australia. Just want you to know we're thinking of you all and miss you all at this time. I'm just going to put a shrimp on the barbie. Hey, look, there's a kangaroo. Much love to everybody. See you all later.
Thanks, Luke. And by the way, that's definitely not a kangaroo, dude. That looks more like a horse that's been ridden over by a bus. What has Jesus been doing in the past week, just in our midst? Well, we've got a couple of cool testimonies that we want to share with you. And what's been amazing is kind of like a rise of evangelism just in the past few days. We've had guys like preaching on their roofs, like Russ.
Thank you, Lord, that we can come before you this morning.
And people secretly placing Bibles in the bedrooms of those who live among them. So let's take a look at some of those testimonies right now.
About 2 years ago, I befriended two people who moved from England to South Africa. They're now in a guest house in Mossel Bay. They live next door to me. We got really close and we're best friends today. The time when I met them, I bought one of them a Bible to encourage them to just seek the Lord because they had absolutely no knowledge of Jesus whatsoever. And during lockdown, they invited me to come and live with them, and I did so. And I just really started praying to Jesus to put a hunger in their hearts for him. And then the Holy Spirit said to me, you know what, the Bible that you bought a year ago, just go put it on their bedside table and just, you know, put it there. And I did that last week, Monday. And then around Tuesday, I walked past their bedroom and I saw they were actually reading the Bible. And they started asking me a lot of questions. And yeah, we prayed with them and they gave their hearts to Jesus. So I just really want to encourage you guys to just live the gospel, because even though you don't do it intentionally to make people see you're living that, they do realize it and they see that light shining inside of you and their hunger for it just grows.
I would like to give testimony on something that I've been praying for years now. The other day, one of my comm members phoned me, and during the conversation, I told her about my desire to be able to pray in tongues. And she said, but we could pray about that right now. And we prayed, and within a minute or so, I received the wonderful gift.
Hey Josh, Jen, Kim here. It's nice to be able to connect with you guys. I've got some good news. So on Sunday, after Andrew preached, he threw out the net and he also flashed up a slide that if anybody was interested in responding to that call, they should either WhatsApp us, email us, or get a hold of us. So anyway, two people did respond. And one was from Zambia, a young lady, and a young man from Frieda in the other in South Africa. So I decided I would follow up with him on Monday morning. And in phoning the guy was very emotional. He was a broken young guy and in tears. And he shared his story with me, and I must say I got quite emotional in the process as well. Anyway, after listening to his story and connecting with him, he had the confidence to follow me in the sinner's prayer. And he committed his life to the Lord. It's a wonderful moment for both of us. And particularly for him, this is the best decision that this guy could have ever made.
Amazing stuff, Kim. I personally love those kind of like people getting saved stories, because even more in the lockdown, you know, there's all these obstacles, like we're stuck in our houses and stuff, running out of Wi-Fi, and yet Jesus is doing stuff in the midst of all of that and saving people's souls. It's like my favorite thing. Guys, we're not going to be jumping into worship right now. Instead, we're going to actually shake things up a little bit and have Andrew Selley's apostolic message first. This is something that he really feels the Lord has laid on his heart. It's one of the big wins for the whole week. So please zone in on this. Get a notepad, get a cup of coffee, get a warm blanket, whatever you need, and make sure you're positioned to receive this word. Afterwards, we're going to go straight into a time of worship with Mervis. Let's go, 10-second countdown as soon as I drop this little dude. Here we go.
Thanks so much, Howie. And just for all those guys that are dialing in to watch, it is just such a huge privilege to be sharing with you the Word of God today. And as you know, we are doing a series called Uncorrupted Faith, and we are now in the fourth part of the series. And the title of today is going to be, Can We Claim God's Promises? And we'll get to that in a moment. But I just thought it might be good right now, because up until this point, I've really been trying to tear down parts of our faith that maybe aren't rooted in the truth. And so I've got this deep sense that a lot of us have been shaken, a lot of us are wobbling and really wondering what on earth this means. And so right now on your screen, I want to just put a picture of a house that once was a perfect house. And built, people had lived in it, you know, the electricity was up, the plumbing was working. But then someone had a desire to make it better. And so they tore down the house. And as you can see, you know, the roof is gone, parts of the floor have been torn up, the walls have been pulled down. And if you just look at this house, it looks like this incredible place of, you know, instability. The walls don't seem as secured as they were. A lot of the electricity isn't working right now. And I think for many of us, as we look at this house, this is a picture of what we're feeling right now. There's this feeling of, what is going on? What do I believe? And I want you to know that that's a very normal feeling when things get torn down. So please don't wobble. We're going to rebuild the house. And the house that will be rebuilt properly on the Word of God is going to be far more glorious than the house that we used to have. And I do want to get to the point where we move towards miracles, you know, for signs and wonders. Jesus taught us that if we had faith the size of a mustard seed, which is the smallest of seeds, we would be able to say to a mountain, you know, be removed and cast into the sea, and it would happen. And I want to get to that kind of faith. But before we get there, we have to work our foundations. And so I want to look at today, can we claim God's promises. And I want to distinguish between believing God's promises and claiming God's promises, because God's promises are believable. We must believe his promises. In 2 Corinthians 1 verse 20, we read, all God's promises are yes and amen in Christ. And so every single thing that God promises us is true. It's going to come to pass. The challenge is believing in the promises and claiming them. And there is a difference, because claiming them is where I start to actually try and take control of how that promise is going to work out. And I think this is an area that a lot of us do as Christians, and we actually get ourselves in a lot of trouble through that. And maybe to explain, I want to make a point. We can't claim the promises of God, but we can believe them. And let me try and illustrate that quickly as I get into the body of this. As you know, I'm a dad. I've got a 13-year-old daughter. And when she was around 11 or 12, almost all of her friends had cell phones. Now, I had promised her and told her before that I would look after her, that I would, you know, give her what she needs. And I'll never forget the one day having a conversation with her, and she was trying to sell this idea that she needed a cell phone. And so, like, all my friends have got cell phones, and I need a cell phone, and I can't live without it because I can't get onto the WhatsApp groups, and all these different, you know, reasons that she had. And in her mind, she was trying to claim the promise that I'd made to her, the promise that I would look after her, that I would give her what she needs. And she was working that thing because in her mind, she needed it. But the thing is, in my mind, she didn't need it yet. To my mind, she was still too young, and I didn't actually want her having that kind of access to the internet or to even just living on her phone, which so many kids do. I have an impression that screens that we live on so much now aren't that good for us. And so I decided not to. And I checked it just before filming this. And asked her the question, how did you feel? And she said she felt like, you know, that maybe it wasn't right what I was doing. You see, this picture of a dad and a daughter relationship is actually a real picture of our relationship to God. And so often God's made these promises. He's going to look after us. He's going to work things out for our good. And even distinct, unique promises. And we think, okay, then it must work out this way. And it doesn't. And we actually damage our faith. Some of us will say, oh, Andrew, but there's one thing about, you know, maybe the general promises. But what about the specific promises? What about when God specifically says something in his word? And I still think we can misapply that. And I want to show you now why I say that. And the danger is if we misapply, we presume that we know best in a situation and try and apply a promise in the Word of God as a claim and make it happen, bring it onto the earth through something that we do. I think we're in danger of damaging our faith if this is done outside of intimacy, which we will get to in one of the later series. So what I want to do is, in the last series, we looked at Psalm 91, right? Now, Psalm 91, as we know, is a beautiful promise. God promises protection. You know, no arrow will strike you. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you, God says. And so there's protection. He promises long life. He promises all these things. And we looked in the last session about how Psalm 91 applies differently to us as Christians. It doesn't apply the same way as it did to Israel, because we are in a different covenant and a different, you know, God works that out differently for us. A lot of these promises are for us in eternity as a promise. And they could happen to us now, but they're not promises to us now. And so, but the thing I want to do now, we're going to get really naughty, is dig into Psalm 91 as a, what about Psalm 91 for people in the covenant of the Old Testament? What about those that actually had the agreement with God that directly applied Psalm 91 for them? And we know here, I'd obviously be talking about Psalm 91, as I said, was written in the Old Testament to the people of Israel, or to Judah, the nation in the Old Covenant. And so Psalm 91 made these promises. Could they claim those promises for themselves? And I want us to see that they couldn't, because if they did, they were going to get stuck. And then I want to apply that into us in the New Testament. So let's dig in. And before we just jump in, I want to make some thoughts here. God is a person, not a principle. And we are individuals. And I think one of the big mistakes we make as Christians is we try and kind of deal with this one size fits all thing, where we just take bland promises, bland scripture promises, and we say that is how it must apply. And I think as we do that, we actually get ourselves into a lot of trouble. God is not some Hindu cosmic law that just kind of you can tap into the promise and, you know, kind of karma, it's going to work out that way. God is a person. And we can learn about the promises and the ways of God in the scriptures. But we don't know exactly how he's going to act all the time because we don't see all the circumstances. And we don't see, we don't know the unique nuances of how God sees. And so we get ourselves in trouble. And so in the Bible, one size doesn't fit all because we're all unique. We've got different fingerprints. We are totally unique. And therefore, God deals with us in a totally unique way and even applies the scripture to us in a very unique way. And so maybe let's look in the Old Testament, and I want to look at Psalm 91, this promise that God made to Israel or Judah, because that was the covenant that God made with them. And let's look at someone that met all the requirements for God to really give him the blessings of Psalm 91 and see, did it work out like that for him? And we're actually going to be looking now at probably my favorite king in the Bible. He is, for me, the best king Israel ever had. I know many would say David was, but the Bible says some unique things about this king. His name is King Josiah. And we're going to tap into him and learn some amazing things about God's word. So stick with me as we work through this. Firstly, the background to him. For a long time, he was a king in Judah. Israel had divided in two, and one part of the nation was now called Judah, and he was the king over that part. And Judah was generally doing quite well, but for a long period of time, before he came to the throne, Judah had really been doing very badly. And for many, many kings had actually stopped worshiping God, and actually Judah had come to the point where there was almost nothing left of the kingdom of God, almost nothing left of the shadow of what God is like. It was like God, Yahweh, had been taken out of the nation. And King Josiah comes into power at age 8. And for the first 4 years of his rule, he establishes himself. He's not yet able to fully rule. But at 12 years of age, as he comes into full power, he starts one of the greatest reformations, arguably, in the history of the world. And to give you the background, in 2 Kings 23:25, we actually read this, what God says about this guy. And listen to this. Neither before nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did with all his heart, with all his soul, and with all his strength in accordance with the law of Moses. Okay, that is an outrageous claim. Never before and never after was there a king who turned to the Lord as devotedly as this guy did. This was a remarkable king, coming into power at 12 years of age. And what he does when he comes into power is the first thing is the temple, which is really the picture of the church in those days, and there's only one temple, has become a place where false gods are being worshipped. There's actually male temple prostitutes. It doesn't look anything like the religion of the Old Testament, the agreement that God had with his people. And so he starts to restore the temple, this place of worship. And as they're cleaning out the temple, somebody finds a Bible, the law. And for 57 years, no one in Judah has seen a Bible. It's been hidden somewhere in one of the storerooms in the temple. And can you believe this? 57 years, no one has read a Bible. No one has seen the Word of God. And so the guy that finds this brings it to King Josiah, who's actually already started reforming the place because he wants to serve Jehovah. And so this guy brings the book, the law, and begins to read it in the presence of King Josiah. And as Josiah listens to this, he's overwhelmed at how badly he realizes Israel is doing. And he begins to repent. And at one point, the king tears his robes and cries out in grief because he realizes how badly Judah is doing before the Lord. And then he calls the whole nation together and reads the law to the nation. This is the first time in 57 years Judah hears the law. And as he calls them to repent, we read in 2 Kings 23:3, then all the people pledged themselves to the covenant. Judah returns to God. She actually repents. And this is like revival. This is like God is doing a miracle in this time. And the whole nation turns around and begins to repent. And the reforms that start to come out of this are huge. Josiah restores the priesthood. And so suddenly you've got priests serving the Lord and serving the people. He restores worship in the temple. He goes around and breaks down every single idol, every single high place. He removes every single pagan priest. Literally, at one point in his reign, there is not one single piece of worship that's not towards Jehovah. And it was beautiful. We were in Israel, I've been a few times. And still today, when you go through Israel, you can see in many of the excavations that we'd go and visit, you can see still today that Josiah reformed Israel better than even David did, because no other king removed all the high places like King Josiah did. This was an incredible move of God and an incredible young leader. He then celebrates the Passover, and the Bible tells us in 2 Kings 22:24 that this was the greatest celebration of Passover in all the history of the kings of Israel. I mean, you've got to think, in other words, the worship and the extravagant praise of God is so big in this Passover that even King David couldn't compare with what was happening in the nation. And so just to pause then and go, okay, you know, Psalm 91 says, whoever dwells in the secret place of the Most High, would you and I, just reading this and the promise of Psalm 91 is made to these very people, do you think that they should be protected? Do you think if we apply the word of God and claim the word of God for them, that God should protect them, that God should give them victory over their enemies, God should cause none of them to die young? Surely Psalm 91 applies here. And then we read in 2 Kings 23:26 to 27, and let's read together. It'll come up on your screen now. Nevertheless, the Lord did not turn away from the heat of his fierce anger, which burned against Judah because of all that Manasseh had done to provoke him to anger. Now, Manasseh was the former king. The new king is now being punished for what the last king did. And so in verse 27, so the Lord said, I will remove Judah also from my presence as I removed Israel, and I will reject Jerusalem, the city I chose, and this temple, about which I said, there shall my name be. Okay, hang on, God. Your people have repented. Your people have come before you in deep repentance. Never in the history of your dealings with your people have there been a people and a king so devoted to you. How could you punish them for something that someone did before them? How could this work out? And this is a question that this should be milling around in your head. How can this be? I mean, think of 2 Chronicles, the classic 2 Chronicles 7:14 that's quoted so often today. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Isn't this another promise? Surely, God, we can claim that promise that you will come and you will heal the land because we have fully repented. And yet, God says, I'm not relenting, and I'm going to destroy Judah. And at this point, your brain should be wanting to just kind of go and pop, because how on earth does this work? How can this be right? How can God be fair and just? How can he be true to his promises if this is what he's doing? You see, we actually want a slot machine God. We want to know how to control God. We want to know 1 + 1 = 2. And when it comes to God, if I can work out how he works, if I can work his systems, then I can get the system to work for me. And this is actually rooted in our sinful nature. And so we even corrupt faith. We even corrupt the word of God because we're trying to apply the word of God like a formula so that we can get control over the creator of the universe and ultimately bring his commandments through claiming them rather than believing him, even when we don't fully understand. All right, so let's carry on. Maybe just to say this, we can also learn that while we can't control God, there's no way to control God, that sometimes there's factors we know nothing about going on behind the scenes, and so we can already make bad choices. And so we need to learn the word of God is the word of God. It never lies. God doesn't lie. But sometimes there's factors that we don't fully grasp, and other times There's a way that it normally might work, but because God is unique and every situation is unique, we don't know exactly which scripture to apply, and we don't know exactly what God's mind is on a matter. We can presume, but we don't know always unless he reveals to us by his spirit. Now, so we've just looked at Israel, or Judah, sorry, and Judah's just been told, even though they've repented, they're going to be destroyed. Well, let's look at King Josiah. Again, I want to remind you that Josiah is the greatest king. He's no other king has served the Lord as devotedly as he has. This is a man who deserves the protection of Psalm 91, verse 5, which says in verse 5, "You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 may fall at your right hand, but it will not come near to you," says the Lord. All right, so Josiah, is he protected by Psalm 91? I mean, Israel is obviously, it's not working out like we thought it would, but let's look at King Josiah. And in 2 Kings 23 to 29, we read about King Josiah. And while Josiah was king, Pharaoh Necho, the king of Egypt, this is another nation, went up to the Euphrates River to help the king of Assyria. King Josiah marched out to meet him in battle. But Necho faced him and killed him at Megiddo. And you go, hang on a minute. This is a king that's serving God, and he dies in battle. And we actually hear how he dies in battle in 2 Chronicles 35:23. It says, "Archers shot King Josiah, and he told his officers, 'Take me away, I'm badly wounded.' They removed him from the battle, took him to Jerusalem, where he died, and he was buried with his fathers." And he dies at 39 years of age. He's a young man. And you think, hang on. Psalm 91, the promise of Psalm 91 to the old covenant kings and people was that God would protect them, that no arrow would strike them. And here this good king dies because of an arrow. At this point, that little house that I showed you at the start of this preach has just been flattened. Do you realize that right now, most of us should be going, what? Like, seriously? What? How on earth do I build my faith? Andrew, you've demolished everything. At this point, most of you want to dial out and go listen to someone that's going to make you feel more secure. And I want to say, stick with me. There is great security to be found in God. But just, we need some of our thoughts demolished so that we can be rooted properly in the faith. And so keep following the series, because actually, as you follow the series, we're going to learn how to have proper faith and a faith that can stand any storm. So the good thing with King Josiah and Judah here is actually the Bible tells us why this happened. And can I just remind you that here we're reading the Word of God. When it comes to our lives, we don't always know why things happen. We don't always have the Bible that directly tells us what God's mind is on every matter that we face. We can learn the general mind of God in the Scriptures. But how is God, what exact Scripture is God applying in my circumstance or in yours as you watch this? We don't know that. And so let's look at what the Bible tells us about Judah and Israel. And the Bible tells us that obviously Judah was supposed to be the place that God's name, he says, "There shall my name be." Judah was supposed to be a picture to the nations of what it looked like to serve God and to have the blessing of God. And the danger is, for so long, Judah had not served God, that the nations around it actually started to go, "Oh my goodness, this God is obviously not God. Our gods are being worshipped in this nation." And so even though there has been repentance, God says, actually, he can no longer afford to have his name associated with this nation. And so it has done this for so long. Its infamy has become so great in the nations that God has to remove his name, because his glory and his nature is being affected negatively by his people. And so he says in 2 Kings 22:17, "My anger will burn against this place, Judah, and will not be quenched." God has now got to judge his people because they've damaged the integrity of his name so badly for so long. You see, there were bigger things at play which they didn't see. And again, I want to remind us that we are told to lean not on our own understanding. God says, "My ways are higher than yours. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways." And so what that tells us is that sometimes there are things that God is seeing from his perspective that we just do not see and we don't understand. And so we want to apply the principle or the promise, and we can't, because we don't actually know what's going on. You see, I wrote this down and I want to just quote this. "I don't need to see fully. I've seen enough to trust and to walk with God." And I think it's a wonderful place to get to as a Christian. I've seen enough of God. I've seen enough of his goodness that I don't need to see fully all the time, because I can trust him even when I don't understand. And 1 Corinthians 13:12 picks up on this, and it actually says, listen to this. For now, that's now, we see only a reflection as in a mirror. But then when he returns, we will see face to face. Now I know in part. Then when he returns, I will know fully. And what that's telling us is that we can see kind of in a mirror. It's like we're looking over reflection on water, and we can kind of see what God's like. We know kind of how he acts. We know that he's good. We've seen enough of reflection to know that he's good, but we only know in part. We don't see and we don't know fully. And so it's very hard then to force God's hand, because we might be forcing him to do something that he doesn't want to do. Like my daughter tried to do with her cell phone. She didn't understand quite what I was thinking about at that time. And so when it comes to the applying of the promise, can we demand, can we force God's hand? I don't think we can, because I don't know exactly what applies here. I don't exactly know what exactly God is doing. I don't actually fully get the big picture, but I do believe and trust in the one who does. And faith here isn't this, I name it, claim it, you know, the word says it, I believe it, therefore, because you don't actually know. The word says a lot of things. You're just pulling some scripture out and making that a promise for you. But that might be a promise that has a unique outworking in a unique situation. And God might be saying something very different in your scenario. We don't know properly, but we know enough to know that we can trust him. And I think I love that about him. And so that was Judah. When it comes to King Josiah, beautifully, the Bible tells us also why Josiah dies. And it says in 2 Kings 22:19 and 20, and listen to this. God is talking to Josiah through a prophet, and he says, because your heart was responsive and you humbled yourself before the Lord when you heard what I have spoken against this place and its people, that they would become accursed and laid waste, and because you tore your robes and wept in my presence, I have heard you, declares the Lord. Therefore, I will gather you to your fathers, and you will be buried in peace. Your eyes will not see all the disaster I'm going to bring on this place. Now, there's a perspective we don't often get. God says, I hear you, and I'm going to protect you. But part of what I'm going to protect you from is my judgment. And so what I'm actually going to do, I have to judge Judah. But I love you. And so what I'm doing is I'm going to actually remove you. And how I'm going to remove you is I'm going to actually kill you. I'm going to orchestrate your death so that I can protect you from seeing the destruction of what I'm going to do in this place. And so it's the mercy of God to kill King Josiah at 39 years of age. Now, there's a perspective you don't often hear on Sundays. You see, Isaiah 57 picks up on this in verse 1. And I love how the New Living Translation says this. Good people die, or good people pass away. The godly often die before their time, before Psalm 91 can be fulfilled. But no one seems to care or wonder why. No one seems to understand that God is protecting them from the evil that is to come. Do you get that? Do you get that God says, I took him to protect him? And so the protection of God here applies differently. Psalm 91, the protection of God isn't that you're going to live to be an old man. The protection of God is that I'm taking you now to save you. And again, we would say, but Lord, death is not a protection. Death sounds terrible. Until we realize that to be with the Lord is the point of it all. I mean, you know, the Bible tells us Enoch is one of my favorites as well. Enoch's this guy that loves God and walks with God. And one day while walking with God, God just takes him into heaven alive. He doesn't even die. And he's just removed. No one knows where he's gone, because God wanted to be with him so much, and him wanting to be with God. Now, is that a terrible thing that God took him, that, you know, that he was suddenly removed from the earth? If it was a beautiful thing for Enoch to walk with God and then be taken into his presence, isn't it a beautiful thing for God to isn't it a beautiful thing for God to take King Josiah to be with him? And maybe Josiah enters in to his presence through death. But make no mistake, King Josiah is right now in the presence of God. and he's rejoicing with thousands and thousands, millions of angels. And he is in a place where there's no more suffering, no more sickness, no more death, no more war. He is in heaven where every single one of us should want to be. And so this changes our perspective, and it makes us begin to realize why we've got to be very careful about demanding the scriptures, demanding and trying to make them work for us, because we just don't see from God's perspective. And so a few big points as I land this. The first one, there's a general rule versus a unique scenario. In other words, God gives us his, you know, the word, and these are the general ways that he works. But the uniqueness of each scenario, we don't actually fully understand. We don't fully know, because we are unique and God is unique and the circumstances around us are unique, and God is working in every circumstance, in all situations. He's working for the good of those who love him. But his mind and my mind are very different, because I only see in part. And so while we do see there's a general rule in the scriptures, normally when you read the Old Testament, those that serve God live to be a good old age. Normally, but not all the time. And so we, learning from that, cannot apply and demand the scripture and make it like, this is what it says, I believe it, therefore it must be. We need to remain intimate with the Lord and hear his voice. And where his voice by the Spirit aligns with the scripture, we know this is the way, walk in it. There's a beautiful clip where C.S. Lewis picks up on this in the Chronicles of Narnia. And in one of the movies, we see Aslan, who is the reflection of Jesus. He's this lion, and he ultimately is going to bring his kingdom to a place that really has fallen, and evil things are ruling. And there's a young girl called Lucy. And at one point in one of the movies, one of the series, Aslan has just established something. There's been a real sense of, you know, Aslan's kingdom and his rule has started to be kind of broken into a place. And then Aslan leaves right in the middle of this. And young Lucy, the scene is going to come up just now on your screen. But young Lucy sees Aslan walking away and wonders, why is this happening? This doesn't make any sense. Let's just play that scene quickly and then I'll pick up on it.
Don't worry. We'll see him again.
When?
In time. One day he'll be here, and the next he won't. But you mustn't press him. After all, he's not a tame lion.
No. But he is good.
Isn't that amazing? Lucy watching a king walking away and thinking, why is he walking away? He should be staying. And she gets told that he is not a tame lion. He's not a tame lion. God is not tame. God is not a pet that I can command and say, sit, and he sits, stand, and he sits. God is God. And we don't fully understand him. He's wild. He's out of our paradigm. His ways are higher than ours. He is not a pet that we can say, well, that's how it must be, because he is infinitely bigger than ours. And sometimes in our lives, like young Lucy, we can see the king walking away when he should be staying. He should be establishing his kingdom. And we need to be reminded that he is not a tame lion. But her response is so priceless. Her response is a response of true faith. And this is what C.S. Lewis wants to work through the books and the movie that we see. He might not be a tame lion, but he is good. And Lucy has seen enough of him to know that she doesn't understand right now, but she knows that he's a good lion. And we also, like her, can sometimes look at what God does and say, I don't fully understand, but I've understood enough to know that you are good. And so God, I can't force your hand. God, I can only trust your nature. The second point in closing is, therefore we can't judge correctly now. And this is a profound thought. We can't judge correctly now, because we just don't know. We see in part. We've got these little blinkers on, and the parts we see often get us confused and messed up. And you know, the Bible says we know in part and we prophesy in part. And often the part we see is just enough to actually get us into trouble. And so why am I sharing this with you? Because I want us to see God who's bigger than the part we see. The parts we've seen have shown us, the little glimpses we've seen of him. Go, oh my goodness, he is so good. Oh my goodness, he's so trustworthy. As you read the Bible, we see the goodness and the faithfulness of our God. But how that applies to us exactly, we don't know. But we can be assured in the kindness and the goodness of our God who has made promise to us that he will work in every circumstance for our good. And I love this. We don't know now properly. And some of us, there might be a feeling of injustice. Well, then how do I know? You won't know until you stand before him one day. The Bible says when he returns, we will see as he sees. Only then will our minds be renewed fully. Only then will our sight be received properly, that we will see what he sees. And the book of Revelation, chapter 19, verse 1 to 2, picks up on this. And it's talking about the final judgment and the wrapping up of it all. And in one of these things, God himself is kind of revealing himself to the various aspects of his creation. And at one point, he reveals himself to us. And this is what it says. After these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God, for true and righteous are his judgments. On that day, we will see everything as he sees. We'll see every situation. We'll see why we lost businesses through Corona. We'll see why people that we loved might have died. We'll see why the nations trembled. We'll see everything then. And in that day, when we see properly, we will go, You were true and you were righteous in all of your judgments. And my friends, faith is this. Faith is looking to that day and believing in the one who made his promises while acknowledging that we don't fully understand now. So finally, God works in all things for the good. And faith is when I don't understand, but I trust. I love, there's a song by a guy called Garth Brooks. It's a very country song. Most of us wouldn't listen to it, but it actually made a number one hit in 1990. And the song was called Unanswered Prayers. And the song, and I think it illustrates the point. He sings about, you know, as a young man, seeing a young woman that he just thought was gorgeous and wanted to marry her and pray to God, God, please move in her heart that she would love me as I love her. And the song goes, how she didn't. And they ended up drifting apart. And this man's prayers weren't answered. And he was gutted and broken. Why did God not answer his prayers? And then years later, as an older man, he was walking in a shop. And he saw the woman that he had once loved so much and couldn't understand why God didn't answer his prayer. And as he saw her and they spoke, he realized how different they were. How there was just nothing in common with her. And how actually the woman that he had now married, he loved more than he'd ever loved her. And his kind of chorus in the song is priceless. He says, just because God doesn't answer doesn't mean he doesn't care. And I think this illustrates the point that sometimes he doesn't answer the way we think he's going to answer. But that doesn't mean that he doesn't care. He is working in all things for the good of those who love him. And so 1 Thessalonians, knowing that God knows what's best, 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 and 18 says, rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, because this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. As a Christian, my friends, God loves us. God is working. We might not understand. We can't claim his promise. We can't make him do what we want him to do, but we can trust him. We can believe him. We can know that he is good and faithful and just and true in all his ways. And when we don't see, we just acknowledge, well, the part I'm seeing is confusing me. But that doesn't matter because I've seen enough to keep my faith. And so my faith can ride through the storm. And so I want to encourage you in closing, rejoice no matter what you're going through. Rejoice if your marriage even now is under trial. Rejoice. God is working. And if you approach him, if you come to him, if you seek his face, he's able to meet you and to heal. If you're struggling in your work, you know, whatever you're facing, and we're all facing so many things right now with the world dealing with this whole Corona COVID-19 epidemic. Here is the promise. And this is a promise we can hold to. God will work even in terrible circumstances for your good in the end. And one day, you and I, in heaven, will look at him and say, oh God, you were just and true in all of your actions. And we will worship him because he is faithful. And so I'd love to close in prayer. Why don't we close our eyes, bow our heads, and please just, if you do that right where you are, and I know you might be watching just in your room, maybe a friend forwarded you this link, but I want to speak firstly to those who are listening and watching that maybe don't have a relationship with God. You are not a Christian. You are not walking with God. You are not in a friendship and fellowship with him. And if that's you, just keep your eyes closed and listen to me. God loves you. He loves you more than you understand. And the hardest thing for him to see is you living your life separately from him. He made you for himself, and he wants to come into your life, and he wants to teach you to walk with him by faith. And very often, our greatest sin in humanity is actually that we have faith in ourselves, not in him. That we have wrestled control away from God, and we want to control our world and our universe. But the problem the Bible says is that we all fail. We all fall short of the glory of God. We all make a mess of this. And if you're listening to this, you might be shaking. And the reason why you're shaking is because the world that you've created is falling apart. And God wants to break into your world. And he wants to hold you and sustain you and secure you in his love. And he wants to teach you to walk with him by faith. And if you're listening to this and you realize that God, as I'm speaking, is speaking to you, you need to hear this. God wants to walk with you, but there is something separating you from him, and it's the very thing I'm talking about. You and I have sinned. We have lived life separately from him, and we've driven God, the one who made us, the one who made it all, out of our world and out of our earth. And we need to acknowledge that. The Bible says that the consequence of that is death, and part of the shaking that's happening is death coming to us and robbing us of the things that give us life. But God so loved the world, he so loved you, that he sent Jesus to die on a cross in your place. And Jesus was forsaken on the cross. He cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And he, even though he lived the life we should have lived, because of our sin, the punishment that we deserve was put upon him. And he was separated from God and tasted death, so that you and I, by believing in him, would receive the free gift of God, which is eternal life. God died on a cross in your place to save you. And if you believe that right now and open your heart, he'll come in and meet with you. And if you want him in your life, I'm going to ask you right now on your screen, you'll see there is a number that you can dial. It'll keep just scrolling over, or a place that you can email. Please forward us your details and we will send you information that'll bring you into a relationship with God. And I'd love to pray with you quickly. Father, I want to thank you for those that realize they've lived their lives separately from you. And I pray right now for faith to turn towards you, that they would yield and follow you and come to know you, that you would show yourself to them and bring them into eternal life in Jesus' name. In closing, let me just speak to the Christians. Just keep your eyes closed. Maybe as you hear this, you've realized that you have tried to control God. Maybe you realize that you have, you know, really tried to claim God's promises. And maybe you realize you can't. You can only trust in the goodness of God. And I feel for some of us, we've tried to manipulate God. We've tried to, you know, force God's hand, like an 11-year-old daughter trying to force her father. But you said, and I think we've come to realize that we don't know properly enough to say, you said. God works in unique ways, in unique circumstances. And so right now where you are, the Bible says we can rejoice in all things, give thanks in all things, because we know that he is working in all things. And right where you are, I want to ask you to start to give thanks to God. This is your fitting act of worship, because faith is seeing him in control, even when the parts we see seem like they're way out of control. And this is faith that's pleasing to him. This is faith that blesses our Father's heart. And so, Father, I pray right now that you would give us that kind of faith. Secure us in an eternal perspective. Secure us in the nature of our God. And we learn about you as you read the scriptures, but we don't know exactly what you're going to do, Lord. For you are not a tame God, but you are good. And we love you for it, God. And we acknowledge our frailty before you and say, Lord, we trust you, for your ways are higher than ours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Keep following us on these things, because there's so much for us to learn about authentic faith. And we are going to get to faith for miracles and faith to move mountains. But right now we're establishing something far deeper. We love you and bless each one of you and pray just God's favor over you in your homes or wherever you're watching. And I'm looking forward to catching up with you next week.
That you will open your heart as wide as you can and love Jesus as extravagantly as you can this morning. Here we are to worship. Let's worship Him.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely and altogether worthy and altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship, here I am. Together. and I will give you all my worship, and I will give you all my praise. You alone You are worthy. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for the scars, Lord. Thank you for the nail pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Oh, and worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Yes, Lord, we crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious and high and lifted up. Yes, you are, oh, Jesus, Son of God, darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy's the Lamb. Yes, we want to sing. Worthy is the Lamb, yeah. Oh, we want to sing today. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy and worthy
worthy, worthy, worthy.
Jesus, you are worthy, worthy, worthy. Jesus, you are worthy, 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 worthy. We worship you. Amen.
There may be some of us watching who have got really big questions with some of the stuff that Andrew was mentioning earlier. And that's totally natural, like he gave us that illustration of the house that's being built. But Andrew doesn't want us to like unnecessarily be struggling with these big questions. And so he's created an opportunity just tonight at 7 p.m. on Facebook. Andrew and his wife, MC, are going to be sitting down and just giving us opportunity to ask him all these questions that are or causing us to feel insecure. Like that's the last thing that that God wants for us to feel, and it's also the last thing that Andrew wants for us to feel. So any questions, guys, whatever it is, in particular relating to what he's just spoken about, bring those questions tonight, and then Andrew will be answering those as he goes through for an hour or so over a good cup of coffee. So make sure you guys join us for that this evening, and hopefully we'll even get some unbelievers tapping in and getting saved in the process. Why not? It's at this point, guys, that I'm going to cut across to a new face on the broadcast. His name is Adam. He happens to be my neighbor. And Adam's got one or two testimonies and thoughts regarding wealth and wisdom and using our finances during this crazy time. So over to Adam and back to me later on.
Hey, you guys in front, you want to go sit inside rather for a few minutes? Why don't you do that? Izzy? So go sit inside for a few minutes. Okay, just so it's a little bit quiet. Take your parachute. Eli, inside. Or be dead quiet. You can choose. Well, hi, I'm Adam. I'm one of the elders in Josh Jen Church in South Africa in the City Bowl congregation. This is my son Jet, who in his own right is a little miracle. So behind me is my house and my car and all our things. Inside are my tools that I love and my TV and our clothes and furniture and all the things that give us comfort and security in our lives. So the reality is that I'm gonna lose it all. The only real question is when. Yeah, so the things we have are all gonna pass away, whether now in Corona or one day when we die. But what we do with it while it is still ours, and while we still have the choice, those are the things that are gonna echo on into eternity. Yeah, so we've even felt the challenge in reduced salaries and uncertainty in the future going forward about what do we do with our resources now. And we felt like God has called us to not be worried just about our own lives, but to actually look past that, to trust Him, but also to obey Him, to still be generous, to still give. And it's been hard. It's not an easy thing to do. Some of my faith has been in my own stuff, but in letting go of that and looking to God, I found faith in Him again. I found security in Him again. And the uncertainty is no less there, but who He is so much clearer and so much more certain in my mind, and that gives me peace. So when you start to do that, when you start to actually take some of your even possibly limited resources and put them out there and make them available to what God is doing, you get to see some incredible things. And in a time that should be really, really scary for a lot of people, we're actually seeing generosity prevail. We're seeing guys give of themselves when they don't have enough for themselves, and it's beautiful. It's really just a special thing, and I think it really reflects what Jesus did. He didn't hold back. He didn't look to his own needs. He said, I have a people who I love, and I'm gonna rescue, even if it costs me everything, and it did.
Guys, just touching on what Adam has said now, I'm sure you've all by now seen that little clip of Nomvula, who's in Josh Jane Church in South Africa in the Dunoon congregation. That clip has gone proper viral. But that story actually fits into a bigger story, a story of an individual saint in 412 who's part of a little NGO, and they felt compelled by the Holy Spirit to make a difference where they can. And the result is a truly crazy story of God's provision. Take a look.
So yesterday I had to move probably like 13,000, over 13,000 Ks of stuff. And I woke up and I'm like, God, I need a forklift. And I just like had this cool faith. It's like, God, I'm doing my best and I need some grace and I need a forklift within 3 hours. I needed to be like, no complications. And within an hour, I had two forklifts. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So when I heard the president announce the lockdown, so I remember just being like, oh my goodness, how is this gonna go? And just knowing, obviously, that I have to fill the gap as much as I can. I mean, you can't do everything. So we actually just started, and it's so cool because I think I got a prophecy a while ago that was like, if you think you dream big, dream bigger.
Yeah, in our church, we had 57 people who didn't had food, who were like desperately in need. Yeah.
But don't they have food in their fridge and in their cupboard?
No, nothing.
So we kind of just sent out, actually it just started with broadcast messages and hustle. Then we got like a bit of food and some 21 days worth of activities for the kids and some hygiene products. And I was like, okay, that's cool.
What are you doing,
man? Yeah, man, I'm trying to mix hand sanitizer, you know. Yeah, and then we can hand over to the kids, you know.
It's starting to get desperate. A week later, like food parcels hadn't come from the government. A lot of families were starting to really, really struggle.
What's happening here, eh?
I'm receiving these food parcels here at Josh Jane during this distressed time of lockdown. We were not prepared for these things. Because right now, we have some food shortages.
So then, a few days into it, we got a donation from Switzerland for 80,000 rand, basically, that's where they came from. We were like, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. And we kept on having to up our goal.
Yeah, because of this lockdown that has been due to the coronavirus. So since I'm not working, and then I haven't paid for this month. So this organization is helping me to have this food.
And then I got a call from a friend that worked at One Day Only, and they were keen to partner with us and put us on their website. And already in 2 days, we got 225,000 rand just from One Day Only.
Today was an amazing day. We went to church to help pick out food and give to others. So we thank God because he provided through people who are in our church and through Boost Africa.
It's been 2.5 weeks? I mean, we've only really raised properly in a week, and we've gotten just under 500. So we were able to feed the Josh Jane people, the congregation, and beyond. From our overflow, we're able to even send resources to other NGOs. And what's awesome is I realized that we actually now distributing from that venue, and we bring in so many people into the church, and it's like Joshua Generation Church. And my hope is that they are aware of the place, and it's a place that people can come to and run to, when they know that it's there.
Hey, well, guys. All right. How are you, brother?
I'm fine, brother.
No, I guess I'm just I'm always asking God to use me. Oh, I'm a mess, but God is someone that likes using messes.
So that's basically my wife, Christine, in case you didn't know. And that's what it's all about, guys. It's about an individual Christian that just gets captured by the Holy Spirit and says, use me. And so, guys, it's been a beautiful time. It's been a bit more of a like a deep time. I don't know if you agree, but I feel like it's been deep and it's been profound. It hasn't been all wacky and all crazy. It's instead it's been focused on like just Jesus and his spirit. So however, there is the wacky and the crazy, because I mean, let's be honest, God is multifaceted. He's wild. So without further ado, guys, I'm gonna leave you guys now with some of these revealing clips from 412 around the world. It's been beautiful to hang out with you. Maybe next Sunday I'll put on my preaching clothes. Okay, see you then.
Praise Dave. Yo, sometimes we must open the cracks in our broken hearts to expose it to Christ's light so that he may shine through us the most. Let's get to it. Forewarn whether the Lord will reform. Clouds of waters are lukewarm. Either you evaporate all ordinary or accept his proposal. Become a solid, that's a Hail Mary. The king's reigning. Overcast, the brides and saints hail him, that's an icy blast. Forecast, the sun will set for 3 days, but on the third, the sun's rays will raise. When the sun is the clearest, love seems the realest. I'm fearless before the Spirit's mighty appearance. When the sun is the clearest, love seems the realest. Fearless.
Sociology with you today.
Okay.
And my first question to you is, would you ever get plastic surgery?
No.
And why is that?
Because I don't eat plastic.
Don't give up, you got a reason to.
That was my one. That was it. That was it.
Sit.
Sit first. Eat. Eat, man.